when World War II ended. The US began conducting experiments with aircraft capable of Mach 1 speed at a steady pace. US engineers knew that supersonic fighters and jets were the future of aerial combat. Some designs were successful, but with technology advancing quickly with every new discovery, the US Air Force wanted to take it to the next level. With the sole purpose of getting ahead of the Soviet Union in the arms race, the rising enemy of the decades-long Cold War, the US government was focused on developing cutting-edge military-grade technology before the Soviets did. The US Army and Air Force requested aircraft companies to develop a design capable of reaching or surpassing Mach 2 and maintaining such speed. The result was the ambitious Douglas X-3 Stiletto. Produced by the renowned Douglas Aircraft Company, who gave the US and the Allies the legendary Douglas SBD, nicknamed Slow but Deadly, and the rugged A-20 Havoc, the Stiletto was a unique piece of engineering. It was the sleekest of the early experimental aircraft of supersonic speeds. It was a one-man jet, made entirely of aluminum, with a very unique look never quite seen before. Nonetheless, although the long and slim fuselage had the looks to accomplish its goals, the X-3 Stiletto fell short of its performance goals. It proved underpowered to the grand idea of reaching Mach 2, as it could barely get to Mach 1. Its testing, though, gave engineers the insights needed to produce the Lockheed F-104 Starfighter. This plane had a similar trapezoidal wing and could successfully reach Mach 2 speeds easily. Today, the Douglas X-3 Stiletto is remembered for its slender look and its ambitious capabilities that distance its design from other iconic Douglas aircraft that were bulky, rugged, and built for intense combat situations. In the years leading up to World War II, the US Army requested that Douglas Aircraft Company study the possibilities of creating aircraft designs capable of supersonic speed. It was 1941, and the US was about to enter the war. American isolationists had put enough pressure on Roosevelt's government to refrain from joining the global conflict. Nonetheless, the embargo on Japan's expansionist empire was a disguised declaration of war that would detonate sooner than expected. With that in mind, and ever since the Japanese began that aggressive expansion in the mid-1930s, the US made efforts to modernize and grow its military across all branches. The Army, Navy, Marines, and Air Corps began replacing their old equipment and fortifying US territories in Asia if the Japanese decided to attack. No one expected any real threat, but they were wrong. When the Army requested that Douglas design an aircraft capable of reaching Mach 1 speeds, or supersonic fighters that could break the sound barrier, the company was already busy producing the legendary Douglas SBD, or Slow but Deadly. This aircraft would become crucial during the first year of the war, especially in the Pacific, when the US was caught by surprise at Pearl Harbor. From 1941 until the beginning of 1943, the Douglas SBD would be the vanguard of the US Air Corps, fighting off the Japanese Zeros in Midway, Guadalcanal, Tarawa, and the Solomon Islands campaign. Ongoing modifications made to the company's most effective aircraft, the SBD and the A-20 Havoc, kept engineers away from focusing on experimental aircraft such as the supersonic fighters. The war effort and the fate of the world came first. Sturdy and steady remained the name of the game. The company had to fulfill aircraft requests shipping overseas to the UK, France, and especially Russia. Stalin was desperate to rebuild his air forces after the furious German advance of Operation Barbarossa. In December 1943, when the tide of the war began to slowly favor the Allied nations, the US Air Force requested again aircraft companies to come up with a Mach 1 aircraft. It was one eye towards the future. in January. Douglas submitted a project for approval, but the program never saw the light. It would not be until June 1945 that Secretary of War Henry L. Stimson approved Douglas's request to develop an aircraft capable of Mach 2 or more at 29,000 feet. The war had come to an end in Europe. New intel gathered from German engineers gave the U.S. valuable information for further technological advances. Besides requesting Douglas to develop their aircraft with Mach 2 capabilities, the Secretary of War established that the airplane had to fly for 30 minutes straight, take off and land under its own power. Douglas began working on an airframe powered by combinations of rocket and jet engines that could produce enough thrust to reach Mach 2. In 1947, plans changed when Westinghouse Company announced it was conducting tests on a unique afterburner-equipped turbojet called J-46. This allowed the Douglas engineers to drop the use of rocket boosters and focus solely on building their new plane around the J-46 jets. When the airframe design was concluded, Douglas and the USAF signed an agreement on June 30, 1949. The company was going to build two prototypes of their Model 499D under the military designation X-3. During the first months, the team at Douglas encountered one problem that would ultimately doom the project. The planned Westinghouse J-46 engines failed to provide the power expected of their size and weight, and were deemed unsuitable for the X-3's slender airframe. They had to be replaced by J-34 engines. The J-46 would have raised the performance of the J-34 from 4,900 pounds thrust on afterburner to 7,000, which would have drastically increased overall power. The team had to make adjustments to the X-3 to fit the J-34 engines and make the most out of it when it came to performance. In 1950, the National Advisory Committee for Aeronautics made a series of recommendations to Douglas for improving the aircraft's design, which had some flaws that would lead to uncontrolled oscillations. Other difficulties led to the cancellation of the second prototype shortly after. The surviving X-3 was finished on September 11, 1952, and it was delivered at Edwards Air Force Base, California, for testing. The final design had a unique and intriguing look. It was unusually slender, with a long, sharp nose, small trapezoidal wings, and an all-metal airframe made of aluminum alloy. It was 66 feet 9 inches long, with a wingspan of 22 feet 8.25 inches, and a height of 12 feet. The purpose behind the thin fuselage design was not about the looks, but about performance to achieve low drag at supersonic speeds. Weighing 16,120 pounds, the emphasis of the X-3 was on its speed. The almost hidden cockpit and the windscreen mitigated aerodynamic heating effects. At the same time, the small, straight wings were designed for optimal speed at Mach 2. The first flight of the X-3 was on October 20, 1952, by Douglas test pilot Bill Bridgman. He had the honor of taxiing it for the first time 5 days before, and to everyone's dismay, the unique design failed to live up to the expectations. The performance of the X-3 was mediocre at best. The X-3 had a clunky takeoff speed of 260 miles per hour. During 20 minutes of testing, Bridgman radioed Major Charles E. Yeager and reportedly told him, quote, "This thing doesn't want to stay in the air." When the demonstration exercise was done, Bridgman touched down at 240 miles per hour to keep the plane stable. In the following months, until December of 1943, Bridgman would make a total of 26 flights aboard the X-3. Things did not change much in terms of achieving better results. Despite design tweaks, the J-34 engines were always going to be underpowered, even with the addition of afterburners from solar aircraft. The X-3 reported a maximum speed of 706 miles per hour and a service ceiling of 38,000 feet. The aircraft was difficult to control, and it was underperforming in almost every aspect. The only way in which the prototype was able to achieve Mach 1 was in shallow dive. On July 28, 1953, Bridgman put the aircraft to limit and reached Mach 1.21 in a dive of 30 degrees from 36,000 feet. On October 21, 1953, one of the engines lost portions of its turbine blades during a flight test, forcing Bridgman to make a single-engine landing on the afterburner. When the contractor test program ended in 1953, the X-3 was finally delivered to the USAF. The X-3 Stiletto flew 20 times under the National Advisory Committee for Aeronautics, or NACA, and the U.S. Air Force. Lieutenant Colonel Frank K. Everest, a veteran USAF pilot, experienced firsthand the sluggish controls at low speeds of the X-3. He called the aircraft, quote, "one of the most difficult airplanes I've ever flown." NACA pilot Joseph A. Walker conducted 8 research flights aboard the X-3 during September and October of 1954. According to NASA spreadsheets, during these tests, quote, "the X-3 was abruptly rolled at transonic and supersonic speeds, but the rudder kept centered. It was during one of these tests, and the only prototype was almost lost forever." On October 27, 1954, at an altitude of 30,000 feet, Walker made an abrupt left roll at Mach 0.92. Besides the expected move, the X-3 pitched up 20 degrees and yawed 16 degrees. NASA author Yvonne Gibbs wrote that after that, quote, "the aircraft gyrated for 5 seconds before Walker was able to get it back under control. He then set up for the next test point. Walker put the X-3 into a dive, accelerating to Mach 1.154 at 32,356 feet, where he made an abrupt left roll. The X-3 reached a G-loading of minus 6.7, and then a plus 7 when it pitched upward. When Walker was able to regain control and land, a closer examination of the X-3 showed that the fuselage had been tested to its maximum load limit. The aircraft could have broken up during the maneuver. After that, the X-3 was grounded for months. Between September 1955 and May 23, 1956, Walker himself tested the aircraft again. NACA wished to understand the phenomenon of roll coupling, which occurred when a maneuver in one axis would cause an uncommanded maneuver in one or two others. After the test of 1956, the Douglas X-3 Stiletto was retired to the National Museum of the USAF at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base. Today, it can be appreciated on the museum's fourth floor as one of the first prototypes created to achieve Mach 1 and Mach 2 speeds in the age of supersonic fighters.